Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Neighborhood Watch 4, After the EMP, by E.E. Isherwood, narrated by Kyle Tait. Chapter 1. Do you think I should have killed Trevor? Carmen stood next to the bed, zipping up her shorts. We'd taken our 30 minutes of break time, most of it in my bedroom. And while it did my body a world of good, my mind went back to survival mode well before the 30th minute.
He was coming at you with a gun last night, she started to say.
No, sorry, I meant when I handed him off to Zen on day 2. Should I have taken him and Pike into the woods and come back out alone?
I don't know, Frank, but I remember you had a good reason for giving him over to Zen. Didn't he steal from the guy? And didn't Zen come to get him as payback? I think you did what any responsible citizen would have done, given the options.
But was it reasonable to think Zen would screw it up and let the guy go? Carmen walked over to me as I sat on the edge of the bed in my jockeys. Her shorts were back on, but she hadn't had time to put on more than her bra up top, a lacy black number that hooked together in the front.
Frank, cut yourself some slack. There is no way you could have predicted the series of events that got Trevor away from Zen, got him to find allies, and then come back here.
She caressed my cheek.
And I certainly don't see you as the kind of person who would walk someone into the woods like that.
I sighed, inhaling the scent of her perfume for a few extra seconds. Some of it was undoubtedly on me, a pleasant problem that could only be solved by a good hot shower, and those no longer existed.
Besides, she went on, you're talking about day 2 of this mess. For all we knew, the lights were about to come back on. You played the hand you were dealt, and you've kept us alive until day 5. So stop thinking of what-ifs, okay?
Now she gave me a playful slap before retreating to find her shirt. I slapped her butt.
Frank,
she squealed. We both had a laugh. Every minute of shenanigans with her provided some extra decompression from the anchor weight of stress sitting in my gut. But the time had come to get back to the real world of the EMP collapse. Thanks, Carmen, I said, switching to my sincere voice.
No, thank you, she purred.
I meant for listening to me talk, I clarified.
I wasn't.
She threw on her shirt, winked at me, collected her weapon, then went to the door out of my bedroom.
I'll see myself out the back door.
Why are you going out that way? I asked.
Frank, don't take this the wrong way. But certain people will look down on a single woman who finds herself attracted to a strong male leader. I can be open about what I want when I'm with you. But out there,
she pointed toward the garage, where the rest of the neighborhood watch hung out.
I want to keep them guessing about my personal life, especially the new people.
We'd been lucky in recruiting additional residents from the other 2 streets in our little subdivision, but none of us on Clownfish had been able to learn more about them than their names, so I could see why she'd want to take things slow.
Bye for now,
she said as she disappeared into the hallway. However, a second later, she stuck her face back around the doorframe, a permanent smile etched on her face. I expected one more wisecrack about how we'd spent our break time, but her voice turned serious.
Frank, you almost died last night. We all could have died. Whatever happens now, don't start second-guessing yourself. I wouldn't change a single thing about what you've done to help us live through this.
I didn't see it as regret or second-guessing as much as an honest after-action report about a survival situation. Could it have been prevented? Did I do enough to end it? How could I avoid similar trouble in the future?
And one more thing, Frank. I wouldn't change a single thing about the last 30 minutes either. But I'm also going out the back door to protect you. A leader has to be seen as above all this.
She stepped sideways to flash her hip and thigh for 2 seconds, a bit like she did when she teased me with her towel over in her house. "Don't worry, I'll act like this never happened. In fact," I closed my eyes and pretended to think before opening them again. "Yep, I don't remember anything from the last 30. Being around you has the same blank emotions for me as if I'd been staring at the wall." She slowly shook her head.
"You men never take anything seriously."
The smirk told me she didn't take my words too seriously either. "Hey, I get it, Carmen. I promise I won't change how I do things when I'm around you."
"That's all I ask,"
she said as she left. A few seconds later, I heard her open and close the heavy sliding door at the back of the house. Almost immediately, someone knocked at the garage door. I hurried to the kitchen, where I found a woman had come in.
"It's me, Penny,"
she said. "Yeah, I see that," I answered in a normal voice. "What the heck are you doing?" She had her hand over her eyes.
"You aren't decent."
I looked down and realized I was still in my jockeys. Living alone for so many years had trained me not to be too worried about what I wore indoors. "Shit, I was getting dressed," I laughed, doing a U-turn back to my room. I was already fighting exhaustion, as there was no such thing as a good night of sleep anymore. But my time with Carmen also served as a blender for my brain. A fresh pair of tactical trousers sat on my dresser. "I'll only be a second," I yelled to the kitchen. I got on long pants, socks, boots, and then went for a clean top. It was a green and yellow button-down Hawaiian shirt with tall palm trees that had AK-47s as trunks and grenades hanging from the fronds instead of coconuts. I'd gotten it after I saw one of my drivers wearing the design. As soon as I had it buttoned, I walked back out to Penny, who no longer had her hand blocking her eyes.
"I didn't mean to come in," she verbally stumbled. "I heard voices and figured you and Carmen were, safe to talk to."
"It's fine. Me and her were just..." I'd promised Carmen I wouldn't tell anyone, for both our sakes. But Penny's impish grin suggested I didn't have to bother. I fashioned my response based on what I knew about the two women. "She told you, didn't she?" Her face went thermonuclear red.
"I'm sorry, Frank. What you and her do is none of my business, but she needed a friend, and I'm married, so..."
The dot 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 at the end of her statement had a forlorn quality to it, like she wished things were different. It was a sentiment I'd picked up any time she mentioned her home life. "Say no more," I said while raising my hand. "Carmen wants to keep this on the down low, and so do I, for now."
"Of course,"
she said, returning to her old self. "Is everything all right?" I asked.
"Yes, I figured you would want to get started on the tasks for the day, including the well. It's kind of my job to bother you before we get hot and heavy."
She hesitated for a few seconds before adding,
"What I mean is hot and heavy at chores."
I smiled at how tongue-tied she'd suddenly become. "Let me grab my guns, and I'll be out."
"Is that the shirt you'll be wearing?"
she asked casually. I looked down at the bright colors and cartoonish rifles. "Yeah? What's wrong with it?"
"Oh, nothing,"
she said, obviously forced. "It's one of my favorites," I added.
"I'm sure,"
she teased.
"Did Carmen see it?"
"Not yet," I offered.
"Hmm."
It took me a few minutes to collect my two pistols and the rifle. Plus, I brought the freshly painted AK-47 inside to keep it out of the rain. By the time I headed into the garage, it looked as if I was a politician about to speak to the masses, save for the cool shirt no politician would be caught dead in. I met the eyes of my closest friends on the street: Luke, Ben, Carmen, Penny, the teens, and the others. but I could only give cursory glances to the throng of people spread out beyond the interior of my garage. There must have been 30 newcomers from the other streets. Instantly, I knew we needed block captains to avoid the congestion. "Hello," I waved. "Thank you all for being here, and thank you to anyone who was here last night to defend our neighborhood. The simple fact we're here talking about it means you kept the bad guys from taking over." A few people clapped.
"Nice shirt,"
a woman's voice playfully heckled from the back. I couldn't tell if it was Penny or Carmen, but they were standing together, conspiring. Several people laughed. It struck me the two women were teasing me to throw the others off the scent of what I'd been doing during my downtime. Rather than take offense, it summoned warm feelings for them both. I kept speaking. "But the new day brings new challenges, so I hope you have a little energy left in the tank." I was 99% sure few of them had recharged as efficiently as Carmen and I had done. But few of them were dodging bullets the night before like I was, so it all balanced out.
"What should we be doing?"
Dante asked, still in his red hockey jersey. He held up the crumpled newspaper I'd taken from the abandoned gas station.
"I've been reading this to see if it had any clues about if we're at war, but it only has articles about an upcoming presidential visit that'll never happen. Some shit about a new cable service coming to Fort Myers we'll never use, and an in-depth profile on the mayor. Nothing worth squat."
I'd come to a similar conclusion after my read-through. "I appreciate you checking that over," I replied to him. "As for what to do..." I pulled out my notepad and made a few quick scribbles on the first sheet. After looking at it a second, I scratched and reordered my list until I had it the way I wanted. "First, I want each street to pick a representative, a block captain who can attend these meetings. As you can see, we're pretty full here today. But more importantly, if we're all standing around here, who is watching our houses out there?" I pointed beyond them. I appreciated the fact LeVar stood watch up at the roadblock, though his wife was in the garage with us. "Second, our strategic situation has changed. I need a group of 5 or 6 to immediately help us dig our well here on the circle." Now I pointed to the island of green in our cul-de-sac. "The parts are already out there, so we only need the manpower to drive the pipes into the ground."
"What do you mean our situation has changed?"
Amanda asked with concern. "The water has stopped flowing out of our faucets," I said matter-of-factly.
"Really?"
she fretted. I'd spent a lot of time projecting our needs over the next few days, weeks, and months, and water was the highest on my list. So high, in fact, our first journey in the truck was to acquire the parts to build a series of wells in the area. The only reason the first well wasn't already in the ground was our lack of manpower while other critical tasks needed to be done. However, once Penny had informed me the water was gone, I knew the well was our top priority again. As expected, the mood of the crowd turned to worry. Mostly the newcomers, but several of my clownfish friends showed deep concern as well. "The other thing we can do is move these cisterns next to our houses so we can capture rainwater, since it looks like a storm is headed our way." It had been threatening rain since the day before, but now a downpour seemed a certainty.
"What about our streets?" one of the strangers cried out. "Do we have to walk over here to get our drinking water?"
"Don't worry, my friends. We brought back enough supplies to build 4 wells. After we dig mine, you'll be able to dig your own." Amanda stepped forward.
"Frank, you plan to give us wells, even before we committed to helping you?"
"Yeah. A friend of mine made me realize we needed enough wells so there was no single point of failure, and no single point for bad guys to attack. Having multiple wells gives us a relief valve of sorts." I wasn't going to explain it was Tyler and his stomach gas that gave me the idea. Thunder rumbled in the distance.
"That's... thanks a lot for that,"
Amanda continued. A few others added to the chorus.
Whoa, no one deserves attaboys until the wells are sunk and giving us water. Right now we need to dig the first one, so we all understand how. I would recommend we have reps from all three streets working together, okay?
I wasn't done with my list. The third thing we need to do is the worst, I'm afraid. People gathered closer.
We need to round up all the bodies in our backyards and put them in one spot. I don't think we're set up to bury that many people, so we're probably going to have to burn them.
As expected, several people recoiled at the mention of burning.
Guys, this is unfortunately a fact of life in our new world. If it was one or two, I'd bury them, but we probably have 20 bodies out there. It would take the better part of a day, and most of us behind shovels, before we got them all in the ground.
Can't we simply toss them out in the woods? Tyler asked. Make them someone else's problem.
The young man stood next to his girlfriend Zoe, who leaned heavily on him.
That would be easiest, I agreed. Hell, I wouldn't mind putting them on the trailer and dumping them on the steps of the Sunnyside Up rehab joint, since they sent them down here to attack us. But neither of these solutions will serve us in the long term. Rotting bodies in the woods would create disease, especially with rains coming, and we have a shallow water table around here, so they could infect the water we're trying to pull up with our well. We can't dump them in the city either, as that act would create more enemies for us, I'm sure.
Probably, Tyler agreed.
Does anyone else have a practical way to dispose of all of them?
Burial at sea? Ben suggested.
Can your boat go in deep water? I asked.
No, he admitted.
The flat-bottom John boat was suitable for calm canal waterways, but not the waves of open water.
So we need a group gathering firewood for our funeral pyre, I finished.
I looked farther down my list, but didn't read them out loud. We needed someone to build the sniper nest in the tree Luke had picked out. I'd love to get those kids reading my survival books, to get them up to speed on our future challenges.
We needed more of the Triton boxes set up in each home, especially on the other two streets.
The cisterns would be great to collect water, but someone needed to set up the filtration parts of the system so the water could be cleaned.
Thunder echoed outside, closer now.
Guys, I'm new to Florida. Does anyone know if that storm might be a hurricane? What would normally happen if it was?
Amanda raised her hand.
We are in evacuation zone B, which means we are in the second most dangerous area for storm surges. I don't know how big our zone is, but I do know everything on the western side of Bayside Road is in zone A, since it is closer to the coast, and it sits a little lower.
They're lower than us, I asked with a little surprise in my voice.
Yeah, Ben piped up.
If you remember where you found me that first day, me and my boat were parked under that tree on the shore of the canal. The water was only a foot or two below the rest of the terrain. Here, behind our houses, the water is 3 or 4 feet lower than our yards, since the builders had to dig down far enough so our canals connected to the ones over there.
When everything in all directions appeared pancake flat to me, even a few feet could make a huge difference.
Won't a storm surge simply come under the bridges? I asked.
It will,
Amanda answered as if reading from a technical manual.
But there is so much open terrain on this side of the highway, it will take a long time to fill it all up, so we should be safe for a time.
That was the key. A big enough storm, lingering for long enough time, could fill any amount of terrain when the entire ocean was behind it.
Maybe I shouldn't have moved to Florida, I chuckled.
Don't worry, Ben assured. As long as I've lived here, we've never had water come up to Bayside Road.
Marco raised his hand. His biceps and forearms were huge. The guy must have lived in the gym before the EMP.
Go ahead, I told him.
He spat a wad of chaw into my lawn before speaking.
I spent a few minutes on the main roadblock at the front of the subdivision, since Bella and others from Barracuda took a shift watching it. She told me a lot of the people are asking for food and water, and some get angry when we tell them they can't come into our subdivision to rest. What should we do up there? Don't let them in, I said right away. But they're getting aggressive, he added. They've been chased out of their homes by other desperate people, and they've been on the move for days. Every subdivision to the south of us turned them away, so by the time they get to us, they are crazy with anger.
I could imagine what they were going through, and I did have sympathy for them, but we couldn't host the entire city of Fort Myers on our three streets. We already had those tent people on Albacore tapping into our reserve food supplies, so any additional refugees we took in meant less supplies for our own survival. The unfortunate reality I'd come to understand from years of reading books about the apocalypse was that there were never going to be enough supplies to go around. Our best bet is to keep them moving north, I recommended.
Could we give them bags of water? Ben asked. Like you did for Trevor's friends?
I looked to Marco.
Are they asking for water? Food and water, yeah, he answered. Then we give them water and send them on their way.
I briefly explained how I'd given the young adults resealable plastic bags filled with water, which were crude canteens. Given the choice between doing nothing and doing something, I was willing to do what I could to help them, as long as they kept going north and didn't try to squat in our neighborhood.
Rainey, would you mind heading to Drummond's place to get some bags, then ride them up to the A roadblock?
I'd chosen her to keep her involved and appreciated. Compared to her brother, who was always stirring things up, the young woman seemed more reserved lately. Lonely, perhaps.
Actually, let's start calling that the front gate. It will make things easier for us.
Yes, sir. And yes, sir, she answered.
I took another look at my long list of tasks. I wanted time to inspect Orange Crush, the damaged pickup truck we'd recovered. I needed to put a kill switch in the Unimog. I needed to clean the broken glass out of the El Camino and see if the spray of bullets had damaged anything important. The list went on. One aspect I didn't truly appreciate from reading my books is how much needed to be done in any given day. Carmen forced me to take that 30-minute time out, but there wouldn't be another break until nightfall. More thunder rolled on the horizon.
That's enough for now, I advised. If we get the block captains, I can assign smaller tasks as they come up, or as work crews finish what they're doing. Here's the most important thing, and I'm sure you've heard this before. If you've got time to lean, you've got time to clean. I think the founder of McDonald's coined the phrase, but for us it means you've got time to start a new project that will help us stay alive. Got it?
Lots of nodding.
Let's get to it, I said to break them up.
Tyler was on me the very next second.
What can I do for you? I asked. Uncle Frank, this is serious, he said,
not at all his usual chipper self.
Lay it on me, I replied with similar gravity. First off, that's a drippy shirt, he said matter-of-factly.
Thanks, I replied. I hoped drippy meant cool. Tyler checked behind him. Zoe and her sister held hands as they walked out of the garage. Once he was sure no one could overhear him, he told me what was on his mind.
What would you think if I borrowed the charger to drive Zoe and Alex to their house so they can bring their parents down here?
It took me a few seconds to study his face and decide he wasn't playing around.
I think I wouldn't like that at all, I said with matched sincerity.
But why?
He asked, emotion sneaking into his teen voice.
What did your dad say? I pressed.
He rubbed the back of his neck.
He doesn't have to know, does he?
Let me ask you a different question. Why do you want to take the girls by yourself? Tyler put on a brave face.
They wouldn't want me to share this, but both of them are pretty messed up from shooting all those people last night.
They didn't shoot them all, I reminded him. In fact, they might not have downed any of the bad guys, since they were using lightweight 22s.
They don't care about the details, he insisted.
They walked through all the bodies like the rest of us.
I think it messed them up. I tried to keep them entertained when we were working on the map in your garage, but that only went so far. I think they really miss their mom and dad.
Well, if you couldn't cheer them up, I mused.
Right? He snapped. It would be epic if you let me take them home.
And what if they decided to stay there? I asked.
No, they would come back. I'm sure of it.
Really? I had no idea either way, but I wanted the teen boy to get some experience thinking things through to possible conclusions. Would you stay with them if they did? How would your parents know which choice you made? What if your parents had to come and get you? He gazed down at his feet.
I really like her, Uncle Frank. I don't like to see Zoe or her sister in pain. It really ruins the vibe, you know?
Oh, I know, I said with calm assurance. I know you'd do anything for someone you cared about. So would I.
Is that why you and Carmen snuck off?
He said with some of his old charm.
We didn't sneak anywhere, I answered.
If Penny and Carmen had used my shirt as a distraction, their effort had obviously failed on at least one person.
Me and Zoe watched Carmen and Penny go into your house. Are you banging both of them?
Dude, come on, I said, speaking on his level.
Banging? It's fine, he said casually. No one even suspects, except me, Zoe, and Alex. Probably my dad, too, since you two are pretty tight. He'd tell my mom, and my mom would tell Rainey, I'm sure.
I cut him off before he named everyone on the street.
Kid, you have an active imagination. I hear what you're saying about the girls, but there is no way in hell you are getting a car to go off on your own trip. Do you even have a license?
No, but what does that matter now?
There are no more laws, baby.
It was the first time I'd heard someone glad to have no laws at all. While I could appreciate why he'd said it, I was certain if I stopped and explained what happened to most people when the law disappeared, he wouldn't be singing the same tune. However, it wasn't the time or place for a lecture. I needed to be firm with the kid.
I'm a hard no on you taking the girls alone, okay?
I tapped his shoulder so he looked me in the eyes. I need to hear you say it.
I won't take the girls home.
You won't touch any of the vehicles or bikes, I added. Say it, please.
I won't touch the bikes or any of the new trucks.
We stood there in my garage for a few moments. For me, I was thinking through all the ways Tyler could sneak away and rescue his girlfriend. I'd been a 16-year-old boy at one time, and there were times I would have put myself in any amount of danger to impress the opposite sex. There was no doubt in my mind the boy was already thinking of ways around my limits. Would the kid walk them home?
Don't do anything stupid, I said kindly.
He flashed a crooked smile.
I won't.
He spun around and hurried out of the garage to be with Zoe and her sister. Booms came from outside. I walked toward the group prepping to dig the well, but my eyes were on the sky. The thunder kept getting closer. Chapter 2. The well went in the ground easier than I'd anticipated. Chuck had given me some pro tips back at his tractor store, and I put them to use in the field. I didn't bother making the overhead derrick for driving in the tubing as he'd suggested, since the ground was soft and sandy under our street. Plus, we had young bucks anxious to prove themselves. LeVar had come from the roadblock to join the labor-intensive digging project, and he started the competition. Between him and Marco, It was like watching Arnold Schwarzenegger and Sylvester Stallone competing to see who could drive the pipes in faster. Once a 5-foot section was in, the other guy would get the next section, reset the drive cap onto the new coupler, then hit the crap out of it to sink it another 5 feet. I had the pleasure of supervising for a change. While they did the digging, our pump sat in a bucket of clean water to let the leather valves soak it up and expand properly. A breeze kicked up, and it tried to push me sideways. There were clouds moving in, and the day's weather was looking sketchy. When it seemed like things were going okay at the dig site, I waved to excuse myself.
"Where you headed, boss?" Ben asked.
"I think the weather might become a problem," I stated. "I'll be right back." Dante stood close by, puffing on a cigarette.
"Want some help?" he asked.
"Actually, when this is done, you and Marco can pick through our parts to get what you need for your streets, since your wells should be similar depths to this one. Go ahead and get crews working on them today." I went up the driveway to Luke's place. Melanie and Mr. Puppers were in the garage, cleaning one of the grates for the propane grill.
"Hey, Frank, what can I do for you?"
"I need to borrow 3 bikes for a brief trip." The Farmingtons had enough bicycles for their whole family, and then some. Luke was a roadie, with spare mountain and hybrid bikes as part of his inventory. Penny had also left her bike in the garage, so a wide selection of them were in one place.
"Help yourself," she said. "Need company?"
"Not this time," I replied. "Not unless you have a better idea on how to check the weather than riding down to the shoreline and looking into the gulf."
"Can't you climb on our roof?" she asked.
"That won't give us a look far to the west. Plus, if I go down to the shore, I'll pass through friendly territory on the way. I want to see the lay of the land over in Zen's neighborhood beyond his block. We're supposed to be allies, but I don't even know what streets he's got covered. I figure I ought to know that."
"Sounds about right," she answered.
After ensuring there were enough bikes on hand for my needs, I went back to the well crew. LeVar stood over the tubing with a yellow measuring tape hanging into the hole.
"We hit at 16 feet, he bragged. "We've got lots of water."
"Time for the pump," I instructed. The intake of the well was a good distance below the level of the dirty canal water, which had been my main concern when looking at the landscape around our street. It needed to be deeper than the canal, where the water was purified by sand and rock. It only took a few minutes to attach the pump to the top of the tube. "Marco, as our guest, would you like to prime the pump to get it flowing?" We poured the clean water from the bucket into the pump handle, as Dante worked the handle up and down. This created the pressure needed to pull the water out of the ground.
"Holy balls,"
Dante said when the first murky water came out of the spigot.
"You did it, Frank."
I laughed. "Actually, you guys did it. I only bought the supplies." We all stood there watching in amazement as the water came out in a steady stream and got clearer with each pump of the handle. It wasn't a fire hose, but it was enough to keep us alive. Finally, I asked Tyler to bring me something to drink from. He sprinted home and came back half a minute later, carrying a little blue cup. "I should have specified what I wanted," I said. Luke saw the blue sippy cup with a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle on it.
"Seriously? Is that what he asked for? It's a cup!"
Tyler was in stitches. "It's fine with me," I said, not laughing at all, lest he think I approved of his goofballery. Using the little kid's cup, I collected enough water to take a drink. It was cool and tasteless, which was perfect. As I drank, I flashed a thumbs up to the workers.
"We have water,"
LeVar shouted to anyone in the area. For the next few minutes, I let my friends celebrate a victory, but only for that brief amount of time. Even as the celebration continued and more people brought out cups to test it, I pulled Dante and Marco from the group. Slight change of plans, I said quietly. Before you work on your wells, I need you two to come with me.
Did we do something wrong?
The dwarf-looking Dante answered with self-doubt. You don't know me that well, so I'll give you a heads up about me. If I don't like what you're doing, I'll come right up to you and say so. You two did awesome work here, but now I need reps from both of your streets to come with me and do some diplomatic work with our neighboring subdivision. Marco cracked up.
I'm the last person you want doing politics.
Trust me, I know how you feel. I'm not a political guy either. I doubt any of us are. But you'll understand better once you see where we're going. The three of us mounted the bicycles and were on our way to the front gate when Penny caught up to my rear tire. She was also on her bike, pumping hard to match our speed.
You don't have to come with me, I assured her. We'll be right back.
I want to come with you, she huffed.
I knew better than to wave her off due to any security concerns. She, like Carmen, went out of her way to put herself into dangerous situations, as if she represented women everywhere. And since I didn't expect trouble and wanted to keep it that way, I couldn't deny it might even help to have an extra gun on the team. We rolled through the gap in the C roadblock and cruised past the four construction homes. The least finished one had been picked apart by Lavar and his team as they'd taken plywood sheets from sections of roof and dismantled the interior walls to collect 2x4s. A lot of framing lumber remained, holding up the roof, but it would take more work to get them out. Still, it was a resource we could tap into when needed. We turned the corner onto Poseidon Pier and headed for the front gate roadblock at the end of the street. Along the way, I noted that my neighbors had run some vehicles off Bayside and into the open space on the far side of the canal running along Poseidon. It effectively blocked the open path where the construction crews had gone through to build the canal. It was exactly as I'd requested before the attack the previous night. Not all of my neighbors were on board with what I was doing, but some volunteers from each street had stepped up and done enough. I'd been lucky in that respect so far. Regis and his wife were walking by the first houses of Albacore, as if they'd finished their shift at the roadblock. He and his wife waved to me as they departed. To my surprise, I didn't recognize any of the other residents left manning the 3-car blockade. A young woman met us at the front gate.
This is my girlfriend, Tara, Dante said as soon as we'd stopped.
He then looked at the woman.
This is the guy I told you about, Frank.
Dante was a bald man with a large red beard and a few extra donuts around his midsection, a combination that reminded me of a noble dwarf from the Lord of the Rings, despite being a man of average height. His lady friend was shorter, a bit on the heavy side too, also with reddish-brown hair kept in a short ponytail. Her sweaty, round face wasn't unattractive, but her serious demeanor kept her eyes squinted and brow drawn low, as if she was searching for trouble from everyone, including me.
Nice to meet you, she said.
It looks like you're doing some good work up here, I said, meaning it. She let some of her tension drop.
Man, I don't know about these people on the road. They're about one piece of bad news from shooting the shit out of anything that gets in their way.
Are the water bags working? I asked. It had been an hour since I'd agreed to it at the morning meeting of the watch, and I'd witnessed Rainey ride off with them and come back a bit later.
Yes and no, she allowed. Anyone thirsty is more than happy to take them, but everyone else seems to be insulted when we offer it to them.
Not everyone was blind to what was going on. I was certain men and women who'd studied disasters would realize we were trying to get them to move on. If they were already upset, I could see why serving them water would make it worse. They didn't want a bag of water. They wanted a roof over their head and an armed posse looking out for them and their family. I would want the same. It drove me mad the world had become a zero-sum game.
any piece of food we gave away came directly out of the mouth of Daisy, or Rainey, or the teens from the high school. The only play for me to make was to keep the refugees moving along, while being nice about it. A dozen people passed before someone stood out. "What the actual F?" I blurted. Coming north, walking the shoulder on the far side, two people dressed in dog costumes walked on all fours for several yards, then stood up to stride on two legs for a short time. When they were ready, both dropped down and ran on their four paws for a few more yards.
"Those are furries," Tara commented when she saw the same people. "I worked at a big pet store for a while, and we saw a few of them. They came in with their human masters to pick out puppy toys to play with. They pretend they're dogs. Well, you can see that for yourself."
"I've officially seen everything," I said with lingering shock. Based on the size of the dogs, one a Dalmatian and the other a solid brown color, they were adults, not kids in those costumes. I couldn't even begin to guess what they were thinking. But this was Florida. Florida man was renowned for doing batshit crazy things. Almost as much of a surprise as the costumes was the fact they'd skipped our water station. Those thick outfits had to be scorching hot. Maybe they'd screwed themselves out of clean water by donning costumes with poor visibility? My eyes tracked the dogs until they got far to the north. I then noticed a man and woman walking south. They stood out against all the others heading to the north, like a pair of salmon going the wrong way in a busy waterway. "Hey," I shouted, and waved them over to the roadblock. They diverted as soon as they saw me, but stopped about 50 feet from the cars, suggesting they didn't trust my motives. A smart move, no doubt.
"Did you see those dogs walk by?" the guy asked me.
"Yeah, that was bonkers."
"No shit," he laughed.
"I was curious to know why you were going south," I asked them. The 30-something pair could have come directly from a hike in the woods of Sweden or Norway. The thin woman wore a tight top, tan shorts, and hiking boots, and her straight white hair hung below each shoulder. The blonde guy wore long jeans, his own pair of boots, and a heavy denim shirt, suggesting to me he was hiding a weapon underneath. Despite their pleasant outward appearances, they continuously scanned around them, as if ready to fight off anyone who came into their personal space. In short, they'd seen some action. "Do you need something to drink?" I offered. An orange sports cooler had been set up in the back seat of the silver Lexus, so we could put water in the bags. It seemed polite to make the offer. The guy took a few steps my way.
"Yeah, that would be great."
"Where are you headed?" I asked as Tara filled another bag.
"We're heading home," he said, "but only to get a few of our friends. Then we're all going back to the North Point Municipal Center, where FEMA is coming in to serve food."
"Have you seen them serve food?" I asked.
"Not yet, but they have some people on site. It is apparently designated as an emergency shelter, so the government should soon be bringing in the supplies. There are hundreds of people already there, so someone knows something, you know?"
He took a second to realize what he'd said, and then he chuckled.
"We've got to move, babe," the woman cautioned. "Here you go," Tara said as she held out the gallon-sized clear plastic bag that was about half filled with water.
"Thanks," the guy said as he hurried over and grabbed it.
"How far are you going?" I asked him. "Some of these other people have told us armed gangs are kicking in doors all over the place."
"We've heard," he allowed. "That's why we want to get our friends out of there."
"I can see you've got a good crew," I motioned to his wife.
"But be safe."
"Thanks. You too," the man replied. I watched as the two came together and walked the shoulder on our side of the road as they marched against traffic. Most of the people trudging north moved out of their way, as if they sensed the couple was on a mission that couldn't be stopped.
"Let's keep going," I said to Marco, Dante, and Penny. Dante told his girlfriend where he was going. We pushed our bikes through the front gate. Then we crossed Bayside Road. To my shock, Zen and his boys were already on Poseidon, pushing a four-door Toyota. Ahoy, I said to Zen as soon as I saw him. The hippie-like man jumped off the pushing crew and ran over to us.
Yo, bro, we're doing like you said.
Zen beamed with pride.
We're moving cars to the front of the subdivision, across from you, my pimp.
That's awesome, I replied. Can I take you away from this for a few minutes?
Sure. What are you doing?
Do you have a bike? I asked.
Give me 60 seconds.
Zen whistled at a guy standing on the corner at the end of his street, about 100 yards away. For a few seconds, Zen bent over with his hands out, doing his best to pretend to ride a bike. Immediately, the guy picked up a bicycle and rode it our way. I was impressed at his communication skills. While we waited, I gave him an overview of my intentions. I'm headed to the end of the road. I pointed west, toward the shore. I couldn't see the ocean from our vantage point, but I could see a wooden tower at the public beach at the end of the road, perhaps 2 miles away. While there were lots of houses between us and the end, there was plenty of open space, too. On the way, I hoped to talk to more of his neighbors, if only to determine how much work he'd put into the people around him.
Sure, man. Whatever you want. The beach kinda sucks, but yeah.
His pal hopped off the bike and handed it to Zen. Let's roll, I said to everyone. Zen carried his AK-47 underfolder on his back, same as the rest of us did with our weapons. If it came to a firefight, we'd have to get off our bikes to be effective, but we'd pack a punch. I'd opted not to drive one of the gas-powered vehicles, since I held out hope we could meet some of the neighbors, without worrying if anyone was going to shoot us dead for owning a working car. The more we flaunted them, the more we were going to attract attention, and I wanted to be low-key for a bit, especially if I was going to introduce myself to neighbors who only lived a few blocks over. Which neighbors have you spoken to over here? I asked Zen as we rolled out. He took a moment to catch up.
Well, I've sent guys out to both sides of these first few streets, since they're the closest to the front.
The start of Zen's subdivision was a mirror of our own three streets, except instead of being protected by forest, the houses kept going into hostile suburbia for 2 miles to the west. Other than the long straightaway of Poseidon Pier and the canal running next to it, his area was a maze of roads, canals, and open spaces that was dizzying to try to memorize. You didn't go yourself? I asked in a clinical fashion. As leader, I believed it was his job alone to make contact with new people and set up a relationship.
I don't got time for that, he snarked. I tell my friends where to go. They do all the dirty work.
Zen had a healthy number of young men at his command, but it wasn't yet clear to me how he managed the rest of the people living close by. Where were the retirees, the professional working folks, anyone not involved in the distribution of drugs? We rolled through the bulk of his neighborhood, passing many cul-de-sac entrances, until we entered a big intersection labeled as 40th Street. It was about the midpoint to our destination, a mile to Bayside Road behind us, and 1 mile to the beach ahead of us. I'd already established the grid nature of the main cross streets from looking at my map, but it was more obvious while on the ground. No refugees were on Poseidon, the east-west street, but many plotted north on 40th Street as we went through the intersection. I thought a couple voices cried out for us to stop, but I couldn't be sure. The wind kicked up and made it hard to hear anything for a short bit of riding. By the time we were in calm air, we were 100 yards past the choke point. Stopping for them would have been a mistake, since desperate people were likely to give us trouble,
possibly use weapons to steal our rides. Or worse. The lots beyond 40th became larger, and homes were a bit more spread out on the land. The area was also laid out with parallel streets going east to west, instead of those north-south cul-de-sacs set up like clownfish. In a backyard on the next lane to the north, on our right, I spotted a pool party in progress.
"Looks like fun," Penny remarked when she saw the target of my interest.
"Yeah, maybe," I allowed.
"That's Pax's place," Zen contributed once he zeroed in on the scene.
His tone shifted to anxious, like he wanted to join the excitement, but didn't want to admit why.
"We should take a detour and check it out, don't you think?"
Even from 100 yards away, the pool party didn't interest me. First, if it was Pax, I was a hard no. However, there were 10 or 20 women, almost all of them nude or topless, standing by the in-ground pool, drinking out of fancy wine glasses and lounging on long white deck chairs. A few naked guys ran around in the mix, too.
"We've got to keep moving," I stated in monotone.
Zen wasn't the sharpest guy, but he seemed to catch on to my reasoning.
"I told him what you said," he whispered. "I know most of those ladies. They're all cool."
"That's good to know. Let's keep moving."
The sun wasn't even out. It had been drizzling. And still, they were having a pool party. I took Zen at his word, and I couldn't claim to be an expert in what young people did for fun in this part of Florida. But I still didn't see any need to introduce myself over there. Almost the next house we passed had a man and woman behaving odd, too. The lanky guy stood in his front yard, near his mailbox, and threw baseballs at the fancy shutters over his front windows. They looked harmless, so I stopped.
"What are you doing, friend?" I asked.
He hurled one of the balls with the grace and power of a professional baseball player, and it slammed into the large tan shutter with a horrendous clang. It didn't even dent the metal, as best I could tell from far away. As soon as the ball fell into the bushes below the window, the dark-haired woman ran and picked it up, then brought it across the yard with others held in the lower part of her shirt.
"We're testing our hurricane shutters. These things should withstand anything Mother Nature can throw at it. Get it?"
He held up a ball, giving me the punchline.
"Yeah. I hope you're right."
Some of my neighbors had hurricane shutters, but those must have been optional since my builder hadn't put them on. I hoped that wasn't a mistake I was about to regret. We didn't stick around to watch him, but we heard several more strikes as we rode away. Next, we spotted a man standing on the front porch of a fancy two-story home to my right, and he finally looked like a normal dude. Not naked, not bashing his own property. A boring, normal guy.
"Have you talked to that guy?" I asked Zen.
"Nope,"
he admitted. I pulled the bike over and waved to the resident, anxious to interact with someone who might be helpful.
"I'm Frank Douglas. I live at the other end of Poseidon."
"Stay right where you are," he cautioned me.
"I don't want anything. I only wanted to introduce myself."
"Then you want something," he corrected.
The old guy was outfitted in cowboy boots, tight jeans, and a colorful button-down shirt, as if he'd come directly from the stock auction. However, a large revolver hung from his left hip, perhaps a Smith & Wesson Model 500 like mine.
"Are there people coming up this way from the city?"
I pointed behind me toward the empty lots on the other side of the road, and to the mix of houses and lots to the south. We'd already seen tons of people moving up Bayside Road, and to a lesser extent, inside Zen's subdivision. The next big intersection was a few hundred yards west. That was where a smaller number of people hoofed it toward the north.
"They've been trespassing on my land for the past 5 days. You take one foot in my lawn, you'll find out what I've been doing to the others. I've got a pile out back.
I rolled myself away from the edge of the roadway. Either we'd had a string of bad luck with loser residents, or Zen's whole subdivision was made up of psychopaths.
Say no more. We're not here to give you grief. Zen, my friend here, lives a few blocks that way, and I live across Bayside Road. I'm the guy keeping things running in my neighborhood, and we wanted to see how things are over here.
What the hell does that mean? You got power over there?
Nobody does, I corrected. We're digging wells, collecting water in cisterns, and fixing up old cars so we can get supplies. He took a few steps toward the front of his porch.
You have cars?
Yes, sir, I replied.
My daughter lives down in Naples, he said in a much softer voice. Any way I could get a ride down there?
I knew Naples was somewhere south of Fort Myers, which put it just on the other side of the moon, as far as distance I was willing to drive. I'd be happy to talk to you any time about what we've been doing out there, but for right now you should know, we've been shot at and attacked every time we drive off our street. It's really too dangerous to travel any distance. And Tyler wanted to go off on his own. The guy went back into the shade of his front porch. Well, take care for now, I said, by way of goodbye.
Yeah,
he said, seemingly glad to be rid of us. On the move again, Penny came up beside me.
I don't think anyone is going to be friendly to us.
Why should they? I asked. The world has gone to shit, and the only reason anyone would approach a house around here is to ask for food or water. I can see we've got a lot of work to do to bring these people into the fold. Albacore had been a mixed bag in terms of who came out to help us, but Barracuda had yielded better results. Our subdivision was shielded from the roving groups of people fleeing the city, and the middle street had been on lockdown from the beginning, thanks to Amanda. So they'd been receptive to listening to me explain the new reality to them, and then joining us. Outsiders, like the cowboy on his porch, had already gotten his face rubbed in reality, so he wanted nothing to do with us. When we passed another of the nice homes on the left side, an older gentleman sat on a chair on his porch, but the second I put up my hand to wave to him, he got up and went inside. Message received, I said under my breath. The landscape changed as we neared the coast. A frothy mist rose above a line of trees that marked the edge of the subdivisions. There were more houses on the final quarter mile before the waterfront, as it was the desirable place to live for those who loved the ocean. 50th Street was the last lane before a wooded area wedged between the ocean of homes and the real coastline. A trickle of people walked north along the route, but there were far fewer than Bayside Road or 40th Street. A couple of 10-year-old boys struggled to launch a triangular kite from the yard of the last ranch-style house on the north side of the road. They'd managed to get about 20 feet of string out, but the strong winds made it difficult for them to hold as the plastic frame bent the edges of the kite into a taco shape. The less aerodynamic blob then fell to the lawn.
It's too windy, I suggested.
The nearest lad turned to me. We immediately recognized each other.
You're the ice cream guy, he cheered.
It was the same kid who'd come onto my street on the night of the first day, and I'd gotten him to go home by bribing him with some of our last samples of ice cream. And you are? I tried to think back several days. His curly brown hair tripped my memory. Brendan, right?
That's right,
he brightened. Do you live here? I asked. The boy came to the edge of the street where the five of us had stopped.
I'm not supposed to say, he answered.
I don't live there either,
the other boy cheered. Looking closer, he was a bit younger than Brendan and had similar wavy brown hair, so I figured they could have been brothers. I could also tell by their demeanor they absolutely lived there. You two should be inside, I went on.
This wind is bordering on dangerous.
Listen to the man, little dudes.
Zen leaned his bike over.
We're going to get rocked.
A burst of drizzle came down for a couple of seconds, emphasizing Zen's words. The boys looked at each other, then their kite. After a shared moment, Brendan dropped the kite string and ran for the open garage of his house. The kite wasted no time in blowing into the back of his home. Then it disappeared behind it with a second gust. It struck me a kite might have some utility as a signal device, but I wasn't going to go chase it.
Good luck,
I yelled toward the garage. We rolled out again. A short gravel connector road linked the end of Poseidon with the empty parking lot for the public beach. When we rolled in, my first reaction was that Zen had been right. There was about 100 yards of white sandy beach wedged in between marshy trees and shrubs at both ends. A few overflowing trash cans and a pair of ancient portalettes marked the official support given to the area by whomever was in charge of the place. A rickety 3-story wood frame tower stood at the south end of the beach. It was far too large to be used by lifeguards. Zen saw me looking at the structure.
My dad said this used to be a spotter tower from back in some war. The piece of shit has been closed ever since I can remember.
Can we go up?
Penny asked, her hair flying sideways for a moment.
Bro, you can do whatever you want, but I wouldn't, Zen answered.
The kids seemed to call everyone bro and dude, even the women. I didn't come all the way down here to see trees, I declared. I could see out over the water straight out, but I estimated the tower would give us a look over the greenery to the north and south to see the bigger picture. Tall white-cap waves crashed into the sand about 50 yards from us. Beyond, deep blue water fanned out in all directions under thick cloud cover, but islands and peninsulas created the edges of the huge inlet in this part of the Florida coast, creating the illusion of a giant lake. We weren't looking west toward Mexico. We were looking west toward some thin islands a few miles out. Mexico was 1,000 miles beyond those. I pulled Marco and Dante aside. I want you two to talk with Zen for a bit. Get to know him while I'm not around. You get it?
He doesn't like you? Marco asked.
The guy had another wad of chaw in his mouth. I was tempted to ask him for some, but it was a habit I'd given up years ago. Now wasn't the time to start an addiction, since it would soon be gone. No, he likes me fine, I think, but he and I are peers in running our neighborhoods. I want you two to get your own impressions, without him thinking I'm about to dump a dead body on his lawn. We shared a chuckle.
We understand, Dante said, touching his nose.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.